But I would describe much of the intervention which has followed the great 1929 crash as quite intelligent.
Let's take a further look, though, at this argument that just as during the Depression, far from promoting stability, the government has itself been the major single source of instability.
I don't think there is any stability this side of the graveyard. I don't think it matters what system you're working under. You're not going to have a level and hold it under any system with living human beings.
Governments are larger now and therefore more of a source of an influence for good and for bad. And I think, like Mr. von Hoffman, that you can't get perfect stability, given that you're going to have governments, given that they're legitimate functions of governments, there are also risks in having the government be as active as it is.
Peter Jay.
I think that government is a god that has failed. I think that we have too much of it and need less of it. I think it has failed to prevent both the modern forms of economic instability and the pre-war ones. I do not, however, think that government is the original or primary source of that instability, and I do not think that simply getting rid of the government, or greatly reducing it, which I'm in favor of, will by itself remove the instability.
I would put it this way. There was a great economist with a suitably esoteric doctrine, which could nevertheless be translated, as Dr. Friedman did in the film, into simple English, at the same time as there was the widespread hardship of the Great Depression and the natural yearning of human beings not to repeat anything like it. So you have a coincidence of an appropriate theory with an appropriate public sentiment, and I suppose the symbol in the United States was the passage in 1946 of the Employment Act of that year, which it was a weak measure, but it was nevertheless a public declaration of an obligation of government to do something about employment and economic prosperity, and a good thing too.
Now that's really the crux of the matter. Do you agree it was a good thing too, that obligation was accepted by government at that stage?
I think it's very important here to distinguish two completely different issues. There is a rather narrow issue as to whether Keynes was right or wrong in believing that you could stabilize the economy with regard to really one essential variable, unemployment, by a certain technique which he talked about. We may now think that he was wrong, but that's a quite separate issue from the broad political philosophical issue associated with socialism, associated with social democrats and many other so-called left-wing political thinkers, that the duty of government, so far as it can, is to concern itself not only with defense and law and order and the traditional things, but also with the social welfare and the economic welfare of a society. Now, that's a broad philosophical...
Was that a disaster, as Milton seemed to be implying, or was it a good and helpful and useful thing to happen?
Well, that is one of the great, perhaps the greatest of all debates in political philosophy, as to whether or not it is right or is not right to believe that a society collectively should concern itself with these things and has the right, having concerned itself through law and through government and in other ways, to move to try to correct these things.
But it seems to me, though, Americans have believed that for the last century. I mean, William McKinley ran on the slogan of a full dinner pail, so that the notion that this is a government responsibility for prosperity dates from the 1930s, I think, is erroneous. What I wonder about after having seen that film is this. We have, in 1929, we have the man who could have saved it dead 2 years, and in 1946, we've got the man who might have saved it dying. So what I have to ask is, are we doomed to find out the right answer only too late? Is it possible that our...
For somebody who's recently died.
Exactly. Rummaged through the morgue.
Well, you asked
no,
the question.
But I think the question is a very different one. And it goes to much of the discussion to this point. Everybody looks for the right man. You say government...
Well, you brought him up.
Those men at that time. Right. Quite right. But a system which depends on the right man is a bad system. The Federal Reserve was a bad system because it depended on the right man working it. The idea of demand management, of the kind of thing we're talking about, where Keynes' death mattered, was a bad system because it depended on a particular man working it. The notion that the problem that Bob LeCashman brought up, that the problem is not that government interferes, but it does it unintelligently, is again a demand for the right man, the man on the white horse who will know what to do. My whole view is very different. It is that it's the system that's wrong. And that we've got to have a system that the right way to accomplish these objectives is to have a system which doesn't depend on whether you happen to have the right man pushing the buttons at the right time, but which relies on the on establishing a framework within which an invisible hand, within which the activities of people all over are able jointly to produce the kind of result. It won't produce perfect stability, but it'll produce a far higher degree of stability, a far greater level of freedom, and a far greater level of prosperity than the kind of thing we've had with these governmental interventions.
Well, but somebody still has to design the system. You can't take the people out of it entirely unless you're in the grave.
But the question is,
I mean, it's said that generals always fight the last war. How do we know that the system won't fight the last war? We probably won't have another depression exactly like 1929 to 33. But that doesn't say we won't have another depression or another stagflation or another crisis of some other sort.
But is this process reversible? Because you argued that the public, having been appalled by the Great Depression, in effect demanded of governments that they accept responsibility for well-being of the economy, for management of the society, and so on. Now, that expectation having been raised, can it be reversed?
Let me answer a question you didn't ask and say that it seems to me that what we're getting here is the question of sort of social astrophysics, and that is, do we have an unseen hand, or are we on the war star where we are trying to design a computer that is going to take care of the navigation of this thing? In other words, it seems to me that that's our central question. Is there a mechanism that you can put right in the center of the spaceship that will operate regardless of who is the captain on the quarterdeck at any one moment in time? I don't think that's an economic question. I think that's a question that goes to religion.
Ah, well, that's not on our agenda, actually. I boldly repeat the question, though. The expectation having been raised in the public mind, can you reverse this process where government is expected to produce the happy result?
Oh, no way. And it would be very foolish of the public, which is on the whole more sensible than academics, to come to this conclusion. They look around them. What do they see? They see a whole collection of visible hands attached to Exxon, other large corporations. These are not small, independent competitors jostling with each other for the patronage of the public. These are large organizations with substantial influence on their markets. Government's interference, clumsy as it often is an almost unavoidable response to the very visible manipulations of large organizations.
If there's, again, you're an academic, we're talking about fact and history. Now, the history is that the growth of government has not been as a result of the things you're pointing out. It isn't the large corporations, it isn't the large unions, it isn't the technological development that has produced the major growth of government. The major growth of government in our time has come in the redistributive area. It's come in the area of designing programs which take from some people and give to others. We're not going to go into those here because we discuss those in our next two programs, which deal with exactly the question of whether the government intervention that was stimulated by the Great Depression has been a success or a failure. But to your point, the grounds that you give for greater government intervention have almost nothing whatsoever to do with the actual factual growth of government. Now, at the end of the war, immediately after World War II, it was thought that government was going to get involved, especially in Britain, in France, in central economic planning
on
a large scale.
Of the war experience, too, when government was very much involved.
Germany and Japan as well.
And it's a war. Created a myth just as the Great Depression created.
Or rather reinforced the myth of government responsibility.
Yes, but it created a different myth. Mm-hmm. This is a subject we don't discuss much in the film. We've discussed it in a book that we're bringing out with the same title to go along with the book. But the great myth that was created by the war was a myth that government was efficient. And it was, for wartime purposes, at least in Britain and the United States. It wasn't so efficient in Germany and the losing countries.